Welcome, everyone. I hope you're all having a good day so far. I've got the top of the hour on my clock. We do have a lot to get through today, so I'm going to get started. So the focus of today's presentation is going to be on the GEOWEB Earth Retention System with a focus on the free design software that we offer for design purposes to engineers, contractors, and architects. So I'm your host, Sam Justice, and I'm a licensed professional engineer in the state of Wisconsin with degrees in civil and geotechnical engineering. I'm one of the engineers here at Presto Geosystems, and we manufacture erosion control, stormwater management, and porous pavement products. We're located in northern Wisconsin, and we work all over the US and the world on a wide variety of projects. So we're going to be talking about retaining walls today. So the GEOWEB system works for both main types of retaining walls, gravity walls and reinforced soil walls. So we're going to do a real quick review of those wall types and discuss how they can benefit from the GEOWEB system. Then we're going to get into the GEOWEB MSE wall design software, talking about what it can do and what the analysis actually shows. So by the end, you should have a good idea of how you can use the software to help with designing your own wall projects. So if you do have questions, please feel free to type them in your questions tab in your GoToWebinar menu, and I will try to get to those once we reach the end of the presentation. Okay, so we're gonna start out with a description of what the GEOWEB 3D Soil Stabilization System is for those who might not be familiar with this type of product. So the GEOWEB system consists of two main attributes. The first is going to be the cell or the container size. So the cells come in three diameters, small, medium, and large openings, with cell heights of 3, 4, 6, 8, and 12 inches. So what diameters you're going to want to pick between opening size and cell depth are going to depend on your project-specific details. And we here at Presto can help you determine which one is going to be the most appropriate for a given specific job. So there are also 5 section lengths, so how long the panels come in to best fit your project needs. So quite a bit of variability in the product itself. So the ultrasonically welded seam, which is where all of the connecting points within a geocell are, is going to be very important to the function of a geocell. The stronger this seam strength is, the better overall performance of the geocell. So the material that we use for the GEOWEB system is 100% virgin high-density polyethylene, HDPE, which provides the strongest wall strength while maintaining semi-rigid ductile properties. If you have too stiff of a wall, it can lead to overstressing of the seams and potential cell rupture, which is going to fail your project. Obviously not what anybody wants. Okay, so there's the second main attribute to how the GEOWEB system works as well. And that's gonna be what infill material you choose. There are 3 main infill types that can be used with the GEOWEB system, depending on what exactly you need for your project. And those are gonna be topsoil, aggregates or granular soils, and then concrete. In most cases, the GEOWEB system also allows for the use of on-site materials, so any sort of salvaged materials from excavation, that sort of thing, without the need to import fill. And in general, for today's focus, GEOWEB wall systems are going to use usually either topsoil if you want a vegetated face, or aggregate if vegetation is not desired. And one of the things we like to highlight is going to be the ATRA key. So this is the main component for a completely integrated system, connecting all of the individual GEOWEB panels into a single web that covers your entire project area. It allows for faster installation of the GEOWEB panels and will last the lifetime of the project, ensuring that everything is protected and that the GEOWEB system is not going to fail under anticipated project conditions. And the specific engineering values of this ATRA key will ensure that the system holds up over time without the corrosion seen with using metal staples or failure from underperforming cable tie systems. Another thing I want to highlight is our specification for the GEOWEB system. So in order for a geocell system to perform uniformly, it's critical that the factory welded seams, those internal junctions, and then also the field joined seams that connect all of the individual panels with that after key I just mentioned, which are going to be the mechanical junctions. All of those have to perform at a level that's commensurate with that of the geocell walls. So the three primary elements of any geocell system, the cell walls, the internal junctions, and the connectors, all must perform uniformly as a complete system. Therefore, an incremental improvement in one characteristic, i.e. cell wall stiffness, ESCR, that sort of thing, is only valuable if a complementary improvement is made in the other components of the system. So you don't want to emphasize one over the other. The GEOWEB system is manufactured using our, like I said, high density or high quality virgin high density polyethylene. And our proprietary formula has stood the test of time for more than 40 years. And it contains no fillers, unstable polymer combinations, or exotic alloys. And for most typical sites, the GEOWEB system is going to retain its durability for more than 50 years. We have lab testing indicating 150 years without degradation, even at full exposure to the elements. So we stand behind our numbers so that you can deliver certainty in the solution as you build with materials that you can trust. Okay, so with that, knowing now what the GEOWEB system is, we're going to go into a quick discussion on the fundamentals of retaining walls. So GEOWEB retaining walls are in many ways similar to other mechanically stabilized earth structures, so MSE wall structures. But there are some key advantages to using a geocellular system like GEOWEB to build these type of walls. So walls are defined as structures with a batter of less than 20 degrees. Anything else is considered a steep slope and is usually protected in a different manner. With walls, we think of project failure in terms of bearing capacity, overturning, and sliding. And there's really no limit to how tall we can go with GEOWEB retaining walls. So there's not, you know, a maximum height. So the wall that's pictured here is interesting, both due to its varying toe elevation, as well as its stability as a solution where the wall sits on top of a slope beneath the toe of the wall. So actually kind of unusual project conditions that would usually be a little bit harder to deal with, very easy to handle with the GEOWEB system. And so this photo shows that same wall that we just saw, fully vegetated. And you can see how well it blends nicely with its surroundings. And the decision as to whether to use a wall or a steep slope for a project is going to depend on things like the site topography, the end use of the site, and what soil properties are there. And like I said, the majority of GEOWEB walls are going to be vegetated, so they'll end up looking something like this. And vegetated walls are a core advantage of the GEOWEB earth retention system. And walls may be vegetated for a variety of reasons, including aesthetics and stormwater reduction. The vegetation can capture the stormwater runoff from hard pavements above the wall, or even direct infiltration from rain events, and then integrate that water quickly into the groundwater system or let it evaporate. So now let's talk about gravity versus reinforced walls. Gravity walls don't require any sort of geosynthetic reinforcement behind the GEOWEB face. And here there is a height max. I know I said there wasn't one, but this is kind of a caveat. So 8 feet is generally accepted as the maximum height of a gravity wall. GEOWEB wall or not, any type of gravity wall, 8 feet is really what you can go up to. So these type of walls can go higher under very specific project conditions, but you shouldn't assume that it can. So if you do have something that you are hoping to use a gravity wall for, but know it's taller than 8 feet, please reach out to us and we'd be more than happy to discuss whether or not it would be feasible. So gravity walls and slopes that are designed and built with the GEOWEB panels are going to have between 3 and 7 cells long. So from the wall face deep into your slope. Another, as I said, no other geosynthetics are used. And because GEOWEB gravity walls don't have any sort of tieback reinforcement requirements, they're going to be pretty effective in areas where you have limited space to build up a wall. Now, on the other hand, the majority of GeoWeb walls are going to involve reinforcement of the soil using geosynthetics, most typically using geogrids. General principles of reinforcement are going to be the same as other types of geogrid reinforced MSE walls, such as masonry block walls. And in most cases, a 3-cell panel is used. And so that's going to be the smallest panel size that we offer to help try and minimize the amount of buildup and excavation that might be required. And so these types of walls can require a lot of excavation if they have a lot of tieback requirement needs, but they're not limited in height like gravity style walls. So if you have a really tall wall, this is what you're going to want to use. So while reinforced walls aren't actually limited in height, it still may be beneficial to use multiple tiers of shorter height walls rather than a single very tall wall. And this is because of the length of reinforcement, which is required behind the wall face, and the taller the wall, the longer that reinforcement. So the ratio of wall height to reinforcement length is 70%. So a 10-foot high wall must have 7-foot long reinforcement, and a 100-foot high wall needs 70-foot long reinforcement. You get the idea. So using those shorter tiers allows you to keep the reinforcement length at a much more reasonable length while still achieving your overall required wall height. Okay, so now let's talk about why you'd want to use the GeoWeb earth retention system as opposed to a different type of wall. And aesthetics and cost are going to be some compelling reasons. So GeoWeb walls are aesthetically pleasing and environmentally friendly due to their no maintenance vegetation and their ability to capture stormwater runoff. Using local grasses and flowering vegetation is going to help ensure easy growth and a natural look. And installation of the GeoWeb wall system is fast, and materials are going to be lightweight and easy to assemble. GeoWeb MSE walls are both less expensive for the physical materials and for the labor compared to traditional MSE walls, such as masonry walls or gabion block walls. And compared to many other wall systems, GeoWeb walls have a lower carbon footprint in terms of manufacturing and transportation. So they can help with green infrastructure and low impact development goals and plans on a project site. So that's something that you're interested in, and a lot of people are these days, definitely something to keep in mind. So one of the most significant benefits of the GeoWeb wall is going to be its relative lightweight compared to things like concrete block walls. And so with that lightweight, it has a great ability to tolerate reasonable differential settlement. So building over soft soils or area where differential settlement is a concern is not going to be a problem for GeoWeb walls the same way it would be for something like a gabion block wall. So reasonable differential settlement is going to be different for every project, but in general, GeoWeb walls can handle several inches of differential settlement, which is vital for areas with saturated soil. And using the GeoWeb system can help avoid expensive and time-consuming activities such as surcharge loading a site, which often happens when differential settlement is a concern. So the time required for the surcharge loading may be reduced or even eliminated when using a GeoWeb wall. It also reduces the amount of visual inspection, maintenance, and repair over the lifetime of the wall structure, since the GeoWeb panels can accommodate much more movement than a masonry wall. And GeoWeb walls are going to be the preferred solution when dealing with poor soils with significant settlement potential. A GeoWeb retaining wall saw a major earthquake event, resulting in sliding of the entire slope area. And as you can see, the GeoWeb wall system sustained no damage, but the concrete flumes that were integrated were completely broken. So think of how a rigid concrete wall would have been damaged in the same way. So pretty significant. It's also some really good durability aspects to it. Resistance to chemicals, water, and the freeze-thaw cycle are some additional benefits to the GeoWeb system. And the GeoWeb walls allow water to freely move throughout the cell wall perforations, limiting potential hydrostatic buildup. And reduced potential for spalling and cracking is due to our long-lasting high-density polyethylene that make up the GeoWeb walls. So walls can be built in channels with limited space, such as through neighborhoods, without the need for heavy loading and unloading delivery vehicles. And so the steep side slopes of the channel mean that there's going to be a horizontal footprint is much smaller than if the side slopes needed to be graded out at a 3-to-1 or whatever might be typical. And so the small required construction footprint is pretty well received by anybody who's near these construction sites. And obviously allowing water to pass through is a great benefit as well. Ease of construction, such as around pipe culverts or other structures on site, is also a benefit for the GEOWEB system. So there's no loss of structural integrity due to the infrastructure integration because of the continuous web connections. And the GEOWEB sections can be easily trimmed to fit around large culverts or other structures. And we often hear from workers that it's easy to field fit the GEOWEB panels in place. So that's a great benefit. So the flexibility of the GEOWEB panels allows for walls to conform to existing landscapes and structures. And it's easy to create curves and install things like guardrails right at the top edge of the wall. So you can maximize the available space for roads and infrastructure above the wall structure. Okay, so that was a quick sort of introduction to GEOWEB walls and why you might want to use them, what benefits they have. So now we're kind of going to get into the meat of what we're talking about today, and that's going to be the GEOWEB MSE wall software. So Presto Geosystems offers a free software for designing GEOWEB retaining walls, and it's available on our website. It's completely free. It can be used by engineers, designers, architects, to help determine if a GEOWEB system is going to be appropriate for one of your projects. So the GEOWEB MSE wall software was written by Professor Dov Lashinsky at the ADEMA Engineering Group and can be thought of as an extension of the popular RISA software. Now, you don't have to have RISA installed or to have used that software before to use our GEOWEB MSE program, but it can help. It gives you an idea of how the software is put together. So the program is pretty versatile and can model a range of site conditions, and it can be used for both gravity and reinforced walls. It can also be used for reinforced slopes. So way back at the beginning, I mentioned walls are where you have a batter of 20 degrees or less, so really quite steep. And then steep slopes, reinforced slopes, will be shallower than that. You can obviously go much shallower than 20 degrees if you want to. And this program is something that can help you with that modeling as well. So you're not limited to 0 to 20 degree batter. So as I said, the software is completely free. It does have annual updates so that you know you're getting the most up-to-date and user-friendly system. And it has a pretty simple user interface that walks you through all of the steps that need to be considered. So you can start by choosing between gravity or reinforced walls, and then enter all of your geotechnical information for your soil, that sort of thing. This way you get a site-specific model rather than something that's just a little more general. Excuse me. So the system has a number of different things, including a built-in library of geogrids from a number of different manufacturers to choose from. So you can work with a product that you're familiar with. And there's some room for some customization within the wall system, but there are some general rules that you're gonna follow to achieve a proper design. The software is gonna help you with those, and those are also things that we're gonna talk about today. And in addition to this webinar, we do have some training guides and some simple video walkthroughs available on our website that can help with some of the basic questions about this software if you do come up with something as you're going through. And then we also have some detail about the math and the software reasoning behind how this program functions. So if you do have questions, you can look on our website for those, or feel free to reach out to us directly and we can help you, work through anything that you might have questions about. So the best way that I know how to teach you how to use this software, especially since we're not in person, is to go through all of the steps that we would follow here as our own engineering group to create a project evaluation for you. So we're going to do two of these, and our first one is going to be for a gravity well project. So this case study is going to be about the Hammond Coastal Trail out in California. So this the slope between the roadway and the trail was really badly eroded. It needed to be shored up to allow for safe use of the trail. And slope erosion, especially below roads or other areas with live loads, is really common. And building a retaining wall is a great way to mitigate that problem for the long term, rather than doing minor fixes year after year. Okay, so once you've opened the program, this is your basic starting screen. So you've got all of the standard icons up here, open, save, print. And to get started, you'll pick the far left icon for a blank page for new. So our first question is going to be whether we're designing for a gravity or a reinforced wall. As I said, in our case, this one is going to be a gravity wall. So we can click that and move on to input the data for our model. So you click here. And I apologize, I'm going to go through quickly. We do have a lot to cover. So if there are any questions, please type them in your questions tab and we can go back to them once we're done. Okay, so once you click to input your data, this is a list where all of the data that the program needs to have in order to give us our results. So you've got to fill out all of these tabs. It doesn't really matter what order you choose them in as long as you get to them all, but it's usually easiest just to start at the top. So you can choose what units you want to work with. It defaults to English units, but works in metric just fine. And so then we move on to our general informations tab. So here's where you're going to put in your project information as you want it to be displayed on the final printout. So the time and date auto-populates here, but can be manually changed if needed. The other big one is going to be the designer's name here at the bottom. If you don't put anything in this box, you get an error message. So you just click OK, go back, put your name in, and fix it. So this is the only box that actually has to be filled out, but it is nice to include all of that other information as well. Click on OK at the bottom, and then we come back to our main tab here. So now what we're going to do is get into the meat of building up our model. And so that's going to be this third tab here. Which is going to be for geometry, loading, and other design inputs. So a new page opens up once you click that, and there are a lot of boxes that already have auto-populated numbers in them. You can just ignore those. They don't actually have any meaning. They just are numbers that are there. And so focus down here for a second. So this is a diagram showing what each one of these variables represents in order to build up your model. So the big one to notice are going to be the horizontal lengths A and B at the crest. So there are these are two that are maybe less intuitive than some of the others, like wall height or slope angle. So here's another view of our project site. And we can use this to help define all of our geometry inputs. So the slope angle or the face angle is going to be labeled I. And this is where you need to put in for your site. And usually the steeper the better, but we do often see 1-to-1 or 45 degree wall faces as well. So you do have a lot of freedom with this angle. But like I said, steeper is usually a bit better. So the next value is gonna be beta. And that indicates if there's a slope behind the wall face. So if there's no slope, if it's completely flat behind the wall, the value is zero. We generally try and keep this slope relatively shallow. Think about 3 horizontal to 1 or less, but steep slopes are possible if necessary. So now we move on to our horizontal crest distances, those ones that I pointed out. So the first is A, and this is the distance between the face of the wall and the area with a back slope. This area is always flat, and we recommend keeping this area to be at least 3 feet. So between the face of the slope and the start of your back slope, you want that to be 3 feet just to avoid any potential sliding issues of that back slope. But this area can be zero if necessary. So if your slope is right at the edge of your wall face, A is going to be zero. And then we have B, which is going to be the length of the back slope. In this case, it's right at the edge of the road on the right-hand side of our photo here. So again, this can have an angle or it cannot, but it's going to be the length of any back slope area that you have. Let's see. So sometimes you also have a toe at the bottom of the GeoWeb wall, and that's what's shown as alpha here. So it's not always a feature of the GeoWeb wall, but it can have a big effect on sliding and overturning failures. So definitely don't forget to add it if you have one. Okay, so now that we have all of those things defined, we know what all those variables are, we can come back and enter each one of our numbers here. So that's what I've done for this specific project. A couple points, the height of the wall needs to include an embedment depth. So this embedment is the anchor point of the wall and will always be at least 1 foot deep. So the only real way not to have this embedment is to build the wall on a concrete slab. But in that case, it's critical to include some form of anchorage to prevent wall sliding. So that's what you have to think about here. The embedment is to prevent sliding of the wall. So the wall for this project is 6 feet. So we enter 7 feet in the top box at the height of the wall, and then include a 1 foot embedment depth in that box. So the other point is that you can add surcharge loading values. So you can add a surcharge over areas A, B, or C. So we talked about A and B, and then C is anything behind the back slope. So in this case, we do actually have a surcharge over area C because that's where the road was. So we had our flat area from the face of the wall to our back slope, and then we had, that was A, and then we had our back slope, that was length B, and then our road is on length C. So we add a surcharge load, and you can see where that load is placed in the diagram on the right-hand side. So you can have loads at all three areas at the same time or none at all. And you don't need to add any additional load if you do have an angled back slope. So the program takes into account the weight of the soil if you do have that angle, only if there's additional loads such as live loads or dead loads from roads and buildings. Okay, so that was a lot. Hopefully you were able to follow along. So this is the screen that will appear once you hit OK on that geometry slide. So here's where you can make some decisions about the GeoWeb panels themselves. So the first is a number of steps along the height of the wall. This allows you to control the number of times the length of the panels change so that you can have a wider base and narrower top, which is the standard shape of a gravity wall. Now, the program is automatically going to try and have the least number of steps that it can for simplicity's sake. So we really recommend not adjusting this number unless you have a specific need. This is another option that we generally don't employ. It allows you to control the length of the very top layer of GeoWeb panels so that you can have the traditional gravity wall shape and then have an extended top layer of GeoWeb protection. This may be useful if the wall is directly underneath the road and you need some additional protection against to support that vehicle load. But generally, like I said, we're going to leave this box unchecked. So this section down here lets you choose the size and the depth of the GeoWeb cells. So if we remember back to the beginning of the presentation, I mentioned three sizes, small, medium, and large, and the number of depths that the panels were manufactured in. So in terms of the wall structure, we do have those three sizes, small, medium, and large, but we're limited to two depths, just 6 or 8 inches. And so the majority of the walls are going to use this first option, which is labeled public. And that's going to be the GW30V6. So that's going to be the medium sized cell, 6 inches deep. And this size is going to work for probably 99% of projects. And it's also going to be the cheapest and most easily available size. So if you are wanting to use a different size, I recommend that you contact us so we can discuss the project in detail and make sure we're giving you the appropriate GeoWeb cell size. And then this last area is to choose the minimum number of cells in the GeoWeb panel. So the range is from 3 to 7 cells, and that's the length of them from the face into the wall slope. So the program will generate a model with lengths that are required at the base of the wall, but this is where you can decide how narrow the wall gets at the top. The 3-cell panels are going to be sufficient for most wall structures at the top, so it's a good starting point to choose from. And then we hit OK, and we go back to our main list. So soils information is going to be our next stop. It's best if a geotechnical report or some sort of on-site testing has been done, so you have the specific properties for your soil. But if not, an educated guess is going to work based on your soil type as well. So the soil properties are going to be the internal angle of friction, the cohesion, if there is any, and the unit weight. And there are going to be 3 different soil areas that we look at. So this is the cell infill soil. So this is what's actually being put in the GeoWeb cells at the front of the wall. Then you have the retained soil. So this is going to be all of the soil behind the GeoWeb panels, including any backslope areas. And then finally, the foundation soil, which is going to be the area under which the GeoWeb wall is being installed. So this is obviously a really simplistic representation of how soil behaves in any given area. So keep that in mind as a limitation of this program. And of course, soil doesn't have to mean topsoil. It can be gravel, clay, bedrock, et cetera. Okay, so back to our case study area. Got a little bit further along in construction here. So we have the cell infill soil, which goes directly into the GeoWeb cells. And so this is gonna go into all of the cells, no matter the length of the GeoWeb panel, between 3 and 7 cells. And then we have our retained soil. This is the area behind our GeoWeb panels. Remember, this group includes the soil in our backslope area. And then finally, you have your foundation soil. In this case, the soil that makes up the toe slope. Any soil that is under the excavated area and excavated and built up area counts as our foundation soil. So we enter all our data in this study. Makes it pretty easy since it was the same sandy soil used everywhere, including in the cell infill. So all of the soil properties are the same. Once you're done, you hit OK. So the design parameters tab is up next. So this is a pretty simple screen. And you likely won't change any of the default values here. If geotechnical testing in your area indicates what the potential sliding wedge is, you can enter it, but otherwise the program assumes a 20 degree angle and will try and find the closest wedge angle to that. And the direct sliding coefficient is also something soils testing can indicate, but I'll admit you rarely see projects go for this kind of in-depth soil testing. So I would just stick with these default values that are considered sound engineering practice. Back to our main screen. Our next tab is going to do a lot for some projects and then nothing at all for others. It's about seismic parameters. So obviously, everywhere has their own estimated risk of earthquakes. You don't hear about a lot of earthquakes in Chicago, but if you're along the Pacific Ocean, pretty big concern. So you can determine what the peak ground acceleration is for your area. In our case, the study does take place in Southern California, so the PGA is really quite high. And depending on local regulations, you may have a vertical seismic coefficient that also needs to be addressed. So this is a function of the horizontal coefficient and is needed to take gravity into account. So know your project area requirements and you should be good to go. So back to our screen, we go to the GeoWeb design data. So we just keep working our way down the list. So hopefully this slide looks familiar to you. We saw it pop up after entering our geometry data. So this is an easier way to get to this page if you do want to adjust something. And still the most important thing on this page is going to be the minimum number of cells per panel. If your results are what you're looking for, or excuse me, if they're not what you're looking for, this is going to be one of the easiest changes to make. So hit OK, come back to our screen, and we'll move on to the general factors of safety. So this slide gives you some information, but not actually a whole lot of freedom. You can't really change the factors of safety without adjusting the face geometry. Note one here below states that wall faces greater than 70 degrees, so those with a batter of 20 degrees, use a factor of safety of 1.5, and then wall faces with 70 degrees or less, decrease that factor to 1.3. So our case study has a slope angle of 60 degrees, so 1.3 it is. The really only option you have here is for reduction due to seismic factors. And if you choose either box, the factor of safety is reduced to 1.1. It's noted in note two there. So generally, I like to leave these unchecked, even when I do have a relatively high seismic coefficient, just for an added safety buffer during analysis. So that's what I've done for this project. Follow your own engineering judgment when you're doing these designs. So we're going to hop over to the left-hand side of this menu really quickly and take a look at foundation effects. So this is where you can ask the analysis to account for deep-seated failures if you're interested. This is especially helpful if you know that your foundation soils are weak, if you have significant water movement through the soil, or if really heavy surcharge loads are being applied. So the program uses Bishop's analysis for deep-seated failure, and you can choose what factor of safety you're looking for. And I do want to point out that you don't have to, and in the end, decide that if you want to run the global analysis at all. You don't have to. For a small gravity well like this one, the client really wasn't concerned about the global failure of the slope. So I didn't run one for this analysis. It is up to you whether you think this information is needed for your project, but it's always nice to know you have the option. Okay, so now this takes us to the last tab on our menu, which gives you the option to create a CSI specification for your wall project. CSI is going to be the standard format in the US, but if you're working on a project outside of the country, you can always reformat the information as needed. So this tab actually takes you to our online spec maker tool, which lets you choose all of the specifics that you need. And then you get a generated specification that can be included in submittal documents and be used to ensure that you're buying the right material. I do want to point out that you don't even have to create a spec right now or from this tab. Back on the original model space, there's another tab to create CSI specification that does the exact same thing. So don't worry about having to do this as part of part right now if you really just want to run the analysis. Okay, so we've gone through the whole list, so let's return to the main menu. And once we're back on the main screen where we started, but now you can see the model is based on our data and we're ready to run the analysis. So we want to calculate the GEOWEB layout to determine what is needed to create a successful gravity wall. You'll get this pop-up that's stating that the program is looking for the base length, which is going to be key to prevent movement and failure of the wall. So when the button is ready, go ahead and click it, and then to finish our analysis. So now the bottom two tabs of the main screen are active. These are going to show us our results. We're going to start with the layout configuration. So a new screen pops up to show us our results. The GEOWEB panels are not shown in the model for the full, are now shown in the model for the full height of the wall plus the embedment depth. And you can count how many cells are in each panel. So you can see we have three steps worth of panels, starting with six cells along the base of the wall, moving to four cells in the middle, and then finally three cells at the top. If you remember back on the design data page, you can change the number of steps if you want less. The program is always going to try and minimize it for you if it can. Then you can also choose the minimum number of cells in a panel. We'd chosen three cells, so that's what you see on the top half of the wall. If we had chosen a four cell panel, it would have continued our second step with four cells all the way to the top. If it's something you want to play around with, it's pretty easy. And while smaller panels may be cheaper, it can somewhat benefit if sometimes be a benefit if there are fewer different panels to avoid complications at your site. And so if you click the bottom, down here, our failure wedges are shown, and you can see how the surcharge load from the road influenced the direct sliding wedge. In the end, this is the wall that the program has determined meets all of our required factors of safety, So let's hit the return button and take a look at that. So back on the main page, we're going to look at our tabulated results. So we have two things to look at here, starting with the detailed configuration of the cells. So this is going to be an exportable list for each layer within the wall, telling you how long the layer is and how many cells. You can get the total area of the GeoWeb wall at the bottom, so you can have a sense of how much space it's going to take up in the ground. Our other option is to look at the direct sliding and deep-seated failures, so checking to confirm that we meet our factors of safety for the different failure modes. So we have direct sliding and overturning failures, and we saw those displayed in our layout view. The program doesn't give an exact factor of safety that's calculated, only that it's greater than specified. It's not the most helpful display in my opinion, but you just have to take it as another limitation of the software. You can also get a status of the failure mode in a quick okay, not okay view for convenience. And finally, you can see some data on the bearing capacity, including Q allowable. So there you have it, GeoWeb Gravity Wall. The design and analysis is all done, and we've shown that it will meet our standards for safety and durability. So now all that's left to do is to print out the report. Printing to a PDF is your best option, although you do have some other choices if you want them. So this is what our report is going to look like. So we're going to spin through it quickly. We do have our base specifications for the GeoWeb panels. Then we have our geometry and our surcharge data, plus a rendering of the gravity model down here, which we saw before. Here's some more of our inputs, including our soil data. Again, it was easy because it was the same soil all the way around. And then we move on to the results of our analysis. So this should be everything that we already saw when we looked at those tabulated results. So nothing we don't already know. And then finally, a table of our cell distribution. So we look at the steps or clusters as they're called, but we see that there's 6, 4, and 3 cell length panels. We saw those in the model. And that's all there is to it. Easy enough, right? So I know that was a lot and it can be kind of complicated, but it does become easier the more that you work in the program. And so I know I went through things really quickly and it can be easy to miss stuff, but it's easy to see that our simple computer model can be turned into a beautiful vegetated path as long as that's going to be last as long as we need it to. Okay, so we're going to really quickly do another case study, this time doing a reinforced wall along a creek bed. So there are going to be some differences between this one and the gravity wall. So this was for a project in the Nicolet National Forest in northern Wisconsin. This was another slope below a roadway that was eroding into a creek bed. So it was undermining the road and fouling the creek. A retaining wall in this case, or in this area, needs to both support road traffic close to the edge of the wall face and retain the soil to prevent movement and erosion. Just laying a geosynthetic blanket over the top of the slope might help with surface erosion, but it's not going to address the whole issue the way a retaining wall is. So we'll start with a new model, again, by hitting that blank new tab up in the left corner. We see our main menu, the generic model. This time we want to make sure we have reinforced soil checked. And then we're going to go to modifying our input, same as we did before. So this is going to be the same menu. Some of the internal options have changed, but for now, we're just going to keep going down the list, choosing the appropriate units for the project, remembering to add our project information, including the designer's name, which is required to proceed. And then we're going to get right into the meat of the design with our geometry and loading requirements. So we have the same model space as before, again, with those pretty useless auto-populated values that we're just going to ignore. The explanation diagram is still here, and it hasn't changed either. So we're still looking at the same basic geometry of the walls and surrounding area. Okay, so now we're going to go out and look at our specific project. We see our workers down in the excavated area. So there's the creek bed along the top of the photo, and then the person taking the picture is standing on the road above the wall area. So the wall face is here. We can't actually see it in this photo, but it's quite steep. It's at a 76-degree angle. Then we also have for this project a horizontal area A, which is all the way to the back of the road. So there's no back slope for this project. So a key difference between gravity and retained soil walls is going to be here. For retained soil walls, the area A is going to need to be much larger because that's where the geosynthetic is going to be placed. You can see the geogrids going down for this project. So if our road continues off in this direction, the area B is actually going to be the width of the road. And because it's a road, we can assume it's a flat area, so no backslope angle. And because there's a creek right below the wall, there's no toe slope for this project either. So we come back to our model space and enter our values. Remember to have your embedment depth, again, at least 1 foot, and then add that to the overall height of the wall. And then we have our area A. It's going to be quite long because of that geogrid placement. A rule of thumb, I mentioned it, is going to be geogrids have to be the length of the geogrids has to be 70% the height of the wall. So that'll help with estimating distance A if you don't know it exactly. And then as mentioned, the horizontal area B is the width of the road and it's flat. And then the vehicle surcharge from the road is now over that area B. We can see that here and then also in the model. So this is the wall geometry. It's a bit simpler than what we saw in our other project, but the same basic rules apply. So we hit return in the bottom right. And here is our first real difference between gravity and reinforced walls. So it's a different screen, but it does have some of the same options to pick from. Again, we're going to choose the GEOWEB GW30V6 medium sized cell, 6 inches deep as recommended, and then choose the minimum number of cells. With retained soil walls, we almost always choose 3 cell panels because of the strength of the walls coming from the reinforcement. So we don't need a thick GEOWEB section at the front. Now here's a big difference. This is going to be a list of all of the preloaded geosynthetics in the program. It's really quite an extensive list with a number of different manufacturers to choose from. And then each manufacturer has a range of geogrid strengths to use as needed. You can see that the geogrids are being placed in our project here. The geogrids are placed between layers of GeoWeb panels as close to the front of the wall as possible while exposing the ends. Big difference. So the ultimate strength of reinforcement is here and starts off as the weakest and then gets quite strong. So you'll be able to find the one that works for you. Usually you're going to want to stick with the weakest grids that will do the job to keep costs reasonable. Next is a set of reduction factors for each grid. These are determined by the manufacturer and can't actually be changed. So they're more of an FYI than anything. And then finally, the checkbox at the end where you can choose which geogrids you want to include in your analysis. Like I said, you generally want to start out with the weak grids and move up if you have to. You can choose more than one grid at a time if you need to, which may happen if one type of grid is too weak to do the whole job on its own. The space between geogrid layers is going to be up to you. The program won't stop you from having a large spacing, but the larger the spacing, the less effective the geogrids become. We recommend placing them every 4 GeoWeb layers, which would be about every 2 feet. And then you can choose to start where to start placing them. Convention and ease says put them at the very bottom and move up from there. And then you can also choose the minimum length of your top and bottom GeoWeb layers. This is the same option we had for the gravity wall. And again, we're really not going to do anything here. We're going to let the program decide what's appropriate. So let's hit OK and move on. So we have soils information next. Again, specific geotech data is best for this page, so you have an accurate look at what's happening. Same soil properties are here, and again, limited to just 3 areas. So the cell infill soil, just getting put into the actual GeoWeb cells. And then it's OK if you have more than one soil type on your site. It does just mean that you're going to need to group them together and assume an average set of values that's going to cover all of the different types. It can be tricky at complex sites, but usually 3 groupings is going to be sufficient. So back to our case study area, We have workers starting to fill in the soil, excavated area with the soil. So our cell info material is actually a mixture of topsoil and aggregate. The topsoil allows for full grass growth with a nice final look, and the aggregate helps keep the soil drainable, which is a big concern. Then we have our retained soil, which is really just putting back the excavated soil at this site. So it's a good way to save on material costs as long as your existing soil is still workable. And then finally, you have the foundation soil. The foundation is essentially the creek bed, so the soil is the same type, but it is going to be saturated. So we enter the data back here. And another huge limitation of this program that I have to let you know about is that there's no ability to do any water inputs. So we know that the foundation soil is saturated here, and the client is concerned about hydrostatic buildup behind the wall. So these are things that we need to know as we're designing, but they can't be added specifically to the model. They needed to be included in the construction in a different way. So that's just something that you have to know and keep in mind. So design parameters is next, very similar to the gravity wall, where if you haven't done that extensive geotech testing, you're probably not gonna end up changing it away from any of the default values on this slide. Again, that inclination wedge is 20 degrees based on good engineering assumptions, and the direct sliding coefficients are left at 1. If you do have questions about these values, you can contact us and we can help decide if the default values are appropriate, but they almost always are. Seismic parameters are next on the list, so let's take a look. This project's in northern Wisconsin, which I'm not sure has ever experienced an earthquake, so there's no recognized peak ground acceleration that can be used here. So keep it simple and move on to the next one. So GEOWEB design data is the next tab. Again, it's going to be just a repeat of the slide that we've seen before, just giving you a quicker way to access this info if needed. And remember that choosing the number of cells in a panel can happen here. And we can also change the choice for our geogrids on this page. So nothing more to do right now, but could be useful later. The general factors of safety is next, allowing us to choose how conservative we want to be. Again, a pretty simple slide, not many options. The one that we can change is the factor of safety on the shear strength of the soil. Note that it defaults to a factor of 1. And this has to do with note 1. Basically, in the U.S., there are two main methods for reinforced soil wall design, ASHTO and FHWA, and they recommend different factors of safety. I like to use 1.3 because it is a bit more conservative and will give a more robust design. And then there are also reductions for seismicity, but there's no seismic here for this project, so they're going to remain unchecked. Okay, and then we have our foundation effects. It gives us the ability to run that Bishop's analysis again and see what depth at the analysis is going to consider. Also allows us to choose an appropriate factor of safety for that Bishop's analysis, and then whether we want to run it at all. So deep-seated concern failures were not a concern at this site, so we're going to skip it again. Okay, so we've gotten through everything. It's about as easy as you can keep it. And we're going to get back to our main screen to see our model in place. Then we're going to run the analysis. So we're going to choose this first option over here. The second option is available and lets you manually place each geogrid layer at the height and length you want it. But doing that is very time consuming, and you honestly probably won't do it any better than the program can. So we're going to let the program decide the optimal lengths for our grids. Here again, we have the pop-up telling us that it's running. When the OK button becomes active, we can click it and to finish our analysis and get back to the main screen. So our results tabs are now active. We're going to look at our layout option first. So we have our model rendered here, same as we remember it. The GEOWEB panels are placed for the full height, including the embedment. And then we have our geogrid layers as well, extending back behind the wall. The length of the geogrids is also shown. But we have a problem. So the program has realized that some of the reinforcement layers are overstressed and may fail. And to see what's happening, we can click on the numbers over here, which represent each of the different geogrid layers. So if we click on the number 2, we get a snapshot of what's happening with this layer. Also note that the first layer is along the bottom of the wall, not the top. So it's a little confusing, but you get used to it. And so what we see is that the factor of safety is actually 1.18. And so that is not bad, but we specified a minimum factor of safety of 1.3. So we need to go back to our inputs to change something to fix this. Okay, so we hit the return, come back to our main screen, and we're going to modify our data. Assuming we don't have any control over changing the wall geometry or the soils at our site, our best option for changing something is with the GeoWeb panels and the reinforcement, which is under the GeoWeb design data tab. So we saw in our model that the geogrid at layer 2 was overstressed, so it wasn't strong enough to support the anticipated structure. So the easiest thing to do is choose a stronger geogrid. Here I've selected the next layer of geogrid in the list. I didn't unselect the original weaker grid, and this will allow the program to use both types of geogrids as necessary. So you can do this, or you can switch the whole structure to the stronger grid for simplicity's sake. So that's the only change we're going to make. So we're going to go back to the screen, run our analysis again, and then look at our layout. So it looks like we have the same model, but we have no error in the corner, which is good. And so our geogrid selection worked to fix the issue. So our factor of safety is now 1.3, which is great. And we're using the 3XT material, which is the stronger option we chose. And you can see if we go to the next layer, we are still meeting our 1.3 factor of safety, but we're doing it with the weaker 2XT grid. So we see the program using both types of geogrids, and it is going to default to using the weaker grid when it can. So those are the important things to see. So let's go back to our main menu. And again, we have our tabulated results. So three options this time. So the first is a summary of our reinforcement. Tells us the potential mode of failure for each reinforcement layer, either compound or tieback. And then we can also see what type of geogrid is used. Layer two looks like it's the only one that had to use the stronger grid. And then our factors of safety are here. Everything is over the 1.3 value, which is great. And again, it doesn't give specific values unless they're crazy high. And it's just a quirk of the program that you have to keep in mind. But it shows that it meets the factor of safety we're looking for. Okay, so our next option is a detailed look at our reinforcements. So it helps you determine the total length each geogrid needs to be to resist failure. And again, the mode of failure. And in general, even though each geogrid has a specific total length that's needed, it's easiest to just take the longest length and apply it to all of the layers for ease of construction. And then again, remember, geogrids must be at least 70% the height of the wall. So you're going to want to take the longer of the two values, total length shown here, or that 70% value. And then our last option lets us look at the stability analysis of the structure. So we have direct sliding and then tieback and compound failure modes. And again, a quick, simple OK status lets us know that we've met the required factors of safety. And then we're done with the second analysis. So we can take a look at our printout. It's going to look pretty similar. So specifications, we've got our model summary, our input values, that sort of thing. And then we get to our reinforcements. So we see our mode of failure here, we see what geogrids were used, and then on our next page, we see the actual tieback strength. So this is the value that decides whether or not the geogrid is strong enough. And so we do see that there are some multiple strengths. And then our last page is the stability results, making this a good page to share with others who maybe don't need all of the details. And then finally, a summary of the GeoWeb panels. This is a tall wall, needs 30 layers. They're all the 3-cell panels this time, so it makes it a little easier. And our wall is complete. So this was installed in the fall of 2020, so vegetation was still working its way in at this photo. But it looks great and now supports the wall above it with ease. And the creek bed along the toe of the wall is free to flow as much as it wants. And should the creek flood as it rises up along the GeoWeb wall, there aren't any really concerns about failure. The GeoWeb panels are durable enough to withstand the current and will help hold that soil in place to prevent erosion. So a win all around. So there's one last thing that I want to make clear before we're done, and that's going to be the major limitations of this software. I've touched briefly on these as we've gone along. And the first is that there's only three different soil properties that can be modeled. So if you're anticipating a lot of soil types, you are going to need to move to a more advanced software. The second is that gravity walls are limited to a maximum of 8 feet when using this program. If you do need a gravity wall for a taller project, we can help dig deeper to get the best analysis. And so basically, if you're anticipating a really complex wall design, this program might not be sufficient. It is very limited in the type of analysis it can show. And then lastly, but definitely importantly, this program cannot simulate any water flow. It's simply not an option. So for most walls, this isn't a deal breaker because you're going to use things like free draining materials in the construction, and you're going to install a drainage pipe, such as a perforated pipe like in this photo. And so that's going to help collect and move water along without damaging the wall. So if you are running into any of these issues for your project, we have more advanced software that we can use to help model your job and get you the most appropriate cross-section. So please don't be deterred if your project is complex. But it's always important to know the limitation of any software program you intend to use. Okay, so that was a lot, but we made it. So the GEOWEB system has great flexibility of design. You have a couple different infill materials you can choose. You can do both gravity and reinforced soil walls. And it's all can be done with our free, easy-to-use software. So as I mentioned, we do free project evaluations for the GEOWEB system. So you can fill out the form on our website, include info as you have it. You can attach documents such as geotechnical reports and project drawings. And then we can provide a complete design evaluation, including CAD drawings and supporting documentation. Or in our case, you can run these calculations yourself using the software. It's easy to request a license. It's good for the rest of the calendar year. And then you update your license once a year after that, and you're good to go. Always free. So don't worry about, you know, charges coming later. And then if you do want a check or a second opinion on your results, you can contact us and we can make sure that you're on the right track. And then just something I want to point out really quick. One of the biggest questions we get is about cost. No surprise there. Especially if this is a new technology for you or your area, having an idea of how the GEOWEB system costs compared with other stabilization techniques is pretty important. So here we have a basic comparison for the GEOWEB system for a load support application. So not quite what we talked about today, but it still gives you an idea of how the GEOWEB system fits in with other geosynthetics. So this comparison shows the difference in both price and cross-section depth for an aggregate-only unreinforced section, a section using geogrids and geotextiles, and then two sections with the use of the GEOWEB system, one with aggregate and then one using salvaged on-site materials. So you can see the GEOWEB system is both thinner and cheaper than the other materials, and significantly cheaper when you are able to reuse your on-site materials rather than having to truck new aggregate in. So of course, your mileage may vary in terms of excavation and stone costs, but it's a good starting point. So if you do have questions, feel free to reach out. Always happy to talk one-on-one. And so we are making it faster and easier for you to obtain your PDH certificates. We have a new webinar dashboard where you can view our webinars and then download PDH certificates for on-demand and live webinars that you've attended. Your webinar dashboard will keep a record of all of the on-demand webinars that you've completed, along with your PDH credits earned. A link with this is with more information and instructional videos will be emailed to you in a couple of days. So if you attended live today, you are going to automatically receive a PDH certificate. And then if you watch on the webinar dashboard, you can download your PDH certificate from there. So note that this is going to come from GoToWebinar, not Presto Geosystems. So keep a lookout for it. And depending on your company's cybersecurity setup, you may want to check your spam folder. So just something to keep in mind. And that's our presentation. So thank you so much for attending. I know I went a little long. I hope you were able to get some good information out of this. I will stay on the line and answer questions. So if you have time, feel free to stick around. If not, please feel free to reach out and email them to me directly, or feel free to call me and we can discuss any questions that you might have. So thank you everybody for attending. And I'm going to try and get to you some of these questions. I see that there were quite a few. This webinar is being recorded, including these questions. So they will be available on that webinar dashboard that you're going to get information about. So if you don't have time to stick around, you can review this webinar on the dashboard in a couple of days and the questions will be there. Okay. So let's look at some of the questions here. It was a question about that batter angle. So I did say all the way back at the beginning of the presentation, a wall is a slope that has a batter of 20 degrees or less, so really quite steep. Anything less is a slope. So that's just the technical definition. In terms of how the GEOWEB system is going to function, you can sort of ignore that and say anything basically down to a 45 degree angle, so a one-to-one slope, you can build with a GEOWEB wall in this fashion. So you can make this MSE wall with the GEOWEB panels for really quite shallow slopes down to 45 degrees. So you have a lot of variability, a lot of flexibility in that. So let's sort of ignore the technical definition and go with what's actually physically possible. And we can say anywhere between 45 and 90 degrees, you can create a GEOWEB wall. Next question. One of the photos I showed had a guardrail embedded at the crest. So this is something that is definitely really common. Things like guardrails, fences, windbreaks, simple infrastructure like that. You typically want to put as close to that top edge of the wall as possible. And that's really quite easy with the GEOWEB system. You can embed any of that type of structure right into the top of the wall. You would go through the open GEOWEB cells. So if you have, think, a fence post, you would just embed that through the cells. And then if you need a little extra security, you can use concrete infill around those like fence posts or guardrail posts so that they're fully embedded in concrete, so a little more stable than if they were embedded in soil. And so you can do that, fill in the concrete right into the GEOWEB cells, so you don't need to have an additional block above the GEOWEB cell wall. So that just gives you a little more flexibility to have that integrated structure that you need to finish off your project. So definitely possible. Let's see, there's questions along, can these be used along water structures? So can they be in channels? Can they be seawalls? Can they be anywhere that there's going to be wave action? And the answer is yes, absolutely. So they work really well in those conditions because the GEOWEB panels themselves aren't going to degrade or have any structural issues by being near or submerged in water. And then you have that flexibility of the infill material you want to choose. So if you are doing something that you need something really long or really heavy strength, like a seawall, fill in those outer cells with concrete. And so then you have, basically a concrete seawall that's within the GEOWEB structure. So you have the strength against, wave action or minor impacts, anything like that. You don't have to worry about that. And then you can build up the GEOWEB wall the same way that we've talked about. So much simpler construction than doing, say, a concrete masonry wall. GEOWEB wall is a lot simpler to install. And then you can put concrete in that outer edge and get that strength that you need. So yes, it can definitely be used in and around water. And if you do have specific questions or if you have projects that you want to talk about, we're more than happy to discuss that sort of thing in any sort of detail that you need. Let's see, is there a setback between both the GEOWEB cells and then if you want to do tiers? So in all of the photos, you probably saw that the GEOWEB cells themselves were a little bit set back. So there was a little step between each panel layer. And that's really helpful in terms of growing that vegetation. It gives somewhere for the grass to grow and then grow out. And so the amount of step back there is going to depend entirely on what your face angle is. The steeper it is, the smaller that step back is going to be. If you're down all the way to a 45 degree, you're going to have quite a bit of space in that step between each layer. So that depends entirely on your slope angle. In terms of the tiers, so if you want to do multiple tiers of the walls, like I mentioned, the only minimum setback in the tiers is that you can't place them on top of the GeoWeb wall. So if you build up, you have a, say you have a 20-foot wall, so you're doing two 10-foot tiers. You're going to have your bottom 10-foot tier wall. It's going to have the GeoWeb cells, usually in three cell lengths, so it's about 3 feet. So your minimum setback for the second 10-foot tier wall is going to be 3 feet. So you can't build the second tier immediately on top of the first tier, because that kind of defeats the point of tiers, right? So that's really your only setback. You can go much longer. You can have 5-10 feet between tiers if you want to have, you know, say a walking path or, you know, what have you. You can increase that length. But the minimum is obviously you just can't have the two tiers be stacked on top of one another. Okay, some other questions. Can you run pipes or ducts or anything through the GeoWeb wall out the wall face? Yes, absolutely. So it's if you have, especially in terms of like drainage concerns, so if you have like ducts or anything in the back that are collecting water and you want to drain those out the front of the wall, it's really easy. You would just sort of field cut the GeoWeb panels around your piping. And you, so you would install the pipe where you need them to, you'd cut the GeoWeb panels around those, and then just keep building. And so that's one of those things that sounds really complicated, and it's kind of hard to picture as I'm just sort of talking about this, especially since you don't have anything in hand that you can, you know, touch and feel. But in the field, it actually is quite simple to figure out how to get around that type of structure. So the answer simply is yes, you can go around pipes or ducts or any structure like that. And if you have specific installation questions, we'd be happy to walk through, you know, what steps you need to take. Let's see, some other questions. So what type of select fills are required. So in terms of what type of materials can you use within the GeoWeb cells? And so really the biggest thing that you want to think about is that you need the material to be quite free draining. And that's really just for prevention of hydrostatic buildup. You know, if your whole wall slope is, you know, a really heavy saturated clay, you're obviously not moving water through that very well. And so you have the potential for a lot of hydrostatic buildup there, which could cause wall failure. Obviously, we don't want that. So we do recommend using a free draining material. So most topsoils are free draining. And then aggregates or granulars, so stone or sand, are usually quite fine. Anything like that is what we recommend. If you do want to use on-site material, want to use that anything that you've salvaged during excavation, we do recommend you try that. And if you have questions, feel free to reach out to us. If you can send us, say, a gradation report, or if you've done any sort of soils testing and say, hey, is this material going to be okay? We can give you the go, no go on whether or not we think that that's appropriate. So let's see some other questions. There's some questions about using different types of geogrids in the same wall. So that is something that in terms of installation, why we want to think about keeping these as simple as possible. So you can have a number of different lengths of GeoWeb panels. You can have a number of different types of geogrids, different lengths of geogrids. You have that flexibility, but you just have to keep in mind that each one of those new variables that you include, different panel lengths, different geogrid types, are all areas for potential failure during installation. You could screw something up, you could put the wrong geogrid down, so a weak geogrid is placed where you need a strong one. So that's why we typically try and go as simple as possible. Use a single type of geogrid so that you have it the same in all layers. Use the same length of geogrid in all layers so that you're not having those potential, you know, introductions of failure points during construction. So something to keep in mind, you have the flexibility, but sometimes simple is best. And then Last little bit. What does this say? So does it have the ability to evaluate an inverted configuration with longer embedments at the top and shorter at the bottom? Yes, it does. You do have to do manual inputs for that. So the program wants to do longer at the bottom, shorter at the top to give you the nice sort of conic structure to help build up the wall. If you want to do it inverted, you'd have to do manual inputs. So it just takes a little bit longer, a little bit extra steps. So it does have the option, just not something we covered specifically today. So I've now gone significantly over our time today, but I feel like I've got through most of the questions. If you do have questions that I didn't get to, or if you think of questions later, please feel free to reach out. I'm always happy to talk about the program, talk about the GeoWeb system, how it can be used for your projects, anything like that. So with that, I will say, I hope you all have a wonderful day. Hopefully we will hear from you in the future. And yeah, good luck with all of your future projects. Bye.